everyone. Welcome back. We're going to continue with our next journey in terms of Power BI. And I'm actually here with Matthew Roach, good friend of mine. We started Microsoft on the same day, actually, now over 5 years ago, I believe. And Matthew is going to talk to us about the data stewardship experience. Now, Matthew, I know you're very popular with the audience. A lot of people know you. But just as a matter of that, how about you tell us a little bit about yourself before you go into the details?
Right. Absolutely. Thank you very much, Dandy. So my name is Matthew Roach. I am a senior program manager on the Power BI team. Basically, I work as a feature PM to define a lot of the experiences and the capabilities that are coming in Power Query, the sharing experience, the query management experience, and the data catalog. A lot of the things that we're talking about today are that I'll be showing off. Really, you know, you mentioned Michael's baby, you know, when Power BI went generally available earlier this week. A lot of these capabilities are my babies as well. Before I joined Microsoft, I spent about 15 years as a data warehousing consultant, working with customers around the country and around the world, you know, solving problems related to data and making sure that, people and businesses have the data that they need to solve their problems. The capabilities that we're producing in Power BI and Power Query really are addressing a lot of the information management needs and, you know, the data discovery and data availability needs that we never really had the tools to address before.
So to that part, I mean, making data just available within your organization is one of the key things that, we're bringing with that data stewardship experience, right? Being able to just share out that data within your organization, correct?
Yeah, that's absolutely true. And let's actually jump into the slides. I have the framework to guide that conversation. So, you know, Power BI in general, as Michael mentioned early on, is really the combination of add-ins inside of Excel. We have Power Query, we've got that Power Pivot data model, we've got Power View, we've got Power Map. We have all of these capabilities that let an information worker, these people who work in the business rather than the IT professionals who might be more at home in Visual Studio or SQL Server Management Studio, to have these information workers connect to the data, discover the data, and work with it without needing to rely on IT, or at least while reducing their reliance on IT. So we've got these in Excel capabilities, but at the same time, we also have the cloud capabilities that support the collaboration, the sharing, the discovery, and that data stewardship experience is really a set of features, a set of capabilities, and a set of activities around both the Excel and the cloud components. Matt Mason's session looking at Power Query and this Get Data experience, showing all of the ways that you can connect to different data sources to do data manipulation, you know, things that previously you'd need to rely on a programmer or someone working in integration services or another sort of heavyweight ETL tool. We can now do that directly inside of Excel without needing to worry about connecting to IT or getting onto their schedule or getting their budget approval. We've got those capabilities that are built in. Matt was looking primarily at the capabilities of the add-in itself. Most of the things that I'm going to be showing off today and talking about today rely on the Office 365 cloud component as well, specifically the data catalog cloud service or collection of services. We'll get more into the details in a minute. Matt was sort of freeform going through a lot of demos. I've got a little bit more structure to my presentation. I basically want to start off looking at the problem space. You know, what are the things that we're trying to solve? What are the capabilities? Why are they important? How do businesses use them around information management and how we address those? So start off with the problem space, move on to the solution space, how we address them inside of Power BI with self-service information management, introducing along the way the concept of data stewardship and the persona of the data steward. We'll then take a look at a demo, sort of walking through end-to-end, touching a little bit on Power Query, a little bit on the data catalog, and sort of showing the end-to-end experience to show how business can support itself or business users can support their own needs and the needs of their colleagues while both collaborating with IT, being supported and managed by IT, you know, to whatever degree the company wants, but fitting more into today's reality where people are being asked and businesses are being asked to do more with less. So Let's think about the challenges around information management that modern businesses faced. In Michael's introduction, he talked about how the landscape of data is changing. We've got this phrase, the new world of data. You know, there's more types of data. There's more higher volumes. There's just more data out there, and there is a need to be more responsive around it. And what we see, and this is not just Microsoft. There's a lot of industry research. Gartner and the other analysts have looked at this quite a bit. And if you've worked in the BI or data warehousing or IT space for more than a little while, this is probably going to seem very familiar. But the problem space that we're looking at here is one that Gartner has coined dark data. Dark data is essentially that data that would be valuable to the business and data that exists, but for one reason or another isn't available for use. So it could be that the users who would be using that data, they don't know that it's out there. It could be that it's not in the right format that they need. It could be that they're aware of it, but they don't have permission to access it and they don't know who to ask. Or it could even be that it's there and they can get to it, but they don't trust it. They don't have the ability to understand where it came from, how it's designed to be used, anything along those lines. And the challenges that we see is essentially information workers, because either they can't find it, they can't access it, or they can't trust it, they're spending more and more time reinventing the wheel or tracking down the data, validating the data again, a lot of redundant processes and a lot of wasted effort in order to get the data to solve their problems. While at the same time, IT, if you think about this, the DBA group, the business intelligence group, or the data warehousing group, however it's structured from company to company, IT has a mandate to support the business, but typically IT wants to focus on these broad strategic initiatives. They want to be building this next corporate BI solution or the next version of the data warehouse or supporting an acquisition or a merger or another broad business change. But what we see is IT is spending more and more time responding to these tactical issues. So, I need another column. I need this formatted differently. I need this report. Could you please create this view for me? Because the data that I can access, the view of the data, it might only have 80% of what I need. And by the way, says the business person, I need it by the end of this week, whereas IT is saying we'd be happy to help, but it's going to take 6 months or 12 months or 18 months to get this into the business cycle. So we've got information workers on one side. They need to solve their business problems, and they need to solve it with data. They need to solve it today. On the other side, we have IT pros. These are the guys that are responsible for keeping the servers up and running, making sure that the query performance is acceptable, and for getting the data to the users. And in some organizations, we'll talk more about these guys in just a second, but in some organizations, there are also data stewards who sit sort of with one foot in the IT world and one foot in the business world. They are part of the business, but they tend to have more insight into the data and often a deeper relationship with the IT groups. So if we think about this or reframe this in the context of the problem statement or the information management challenges, we have business users who can understand the data, evaluate the data. They're the only ones that can say whether or not the data is correct. IT cannot say that. But at the same time, IT, the DBAs or the programmers, they're the only ones that can reshape the data, or traditionally they're the only ones. They're the only ones that can reshape the data, share the data, make that data available. So traditionally, there is an ongoing, long-term, and from a time perspective, costly back and forth of data needs identification, data discovery, creating a view or a stored procedure or a report, getting the data into a format where it can be used, and then the business has to evaluate it, request changes back and forth as they iterate over it. Power BI and the data stewardship capabilities inside of Power BI query sharing, query documentation, query certification. They can address a lot of this by enabling the business users, the people who can look at data and say, this is the correct data, and I know because I own this part of the business. They can create these resources and share them with other users. In one way, or from one aspect, they can share it without IT needing to be involved. So I Dandy, say for example, I'm creating information about what the Power BI team is doing, what features are coming out, because we track all of this in TFS. We have Power Queries that we've created and shared out into Microsoft's corporate data catalog. We can get this information available so that someone on the marketing team, for example, who needs to schedule events and do sort of communication, they can see, you know, what's coming, who's working on what the status of things is.
Which is an excellent way of approaching data right now, just the traditional, oh, you're going to share this out by sending an email to another with a spreadsheet or the PowerPoint deck that says, hey, this is a feature list.
Yeah.
Now I can actually just pull that in live, look on what is a feature list, those kind of capabilities. So, yeah there have been some really good, great instruments for us to play with.
When you think about emailing someone a spreadsheet, you know, I got, you know, literally shivers up my back when you describe this, because when you do this, when you share a copy of something with someone else, you forked the data. So you've got this one snapshot, and you know, maybe you only have that and you don't know where the actual data came from. So you're looking at an outdated version of the data and answering questions using it, even though the instant that snapshot was created, the instant you got the email, it was no longer current, it was no longer valid. Whereas with a query, it's simply the instructions to say where to get the data from and how to transform it into its final shape. So if you have access to the query, every time that you refresh it or open it, you've got the current data going from that alternate data
source. Yeah, I mean, you think about it typically in the past, right? And then one of the key examples that I have here is that the event, the Microsoft internal event that we ran recently, is I'm dealing with about 1,000 people that I need to send out a report to. And in the past, this was like, well, here's the Excel workbook with the scores and the feedback scores and so on, and send that out to everyone. It's a small file, but it's filling up 1,000 mailboxes. While now the difference is, hey, here's the link to the Power BI site, and you can go in there with Q&A and ask questions to your own data. How did my speaker perform? How do I compare it against someone else? We know we do that, right? I mean, I was interested in terms of presentation skills, how I compare to a Matthew Roach or anyone else of our star presenters out there. But just being able to get access that way, I mean, I think it's just impressive and the way to go.
Yep, and if you think
sharing
about
sharing the latest,
if you think about that example, that scenario, what you were describing was essentially taking the final product, because you created a workbook. It was based on queries. Mm-hmm. You loaded the data into the data model. You built visualizations. You know, you got the charts showing how, you know, the breakdown between tracks and how track scores and speaker scores compared to each other. You've created this whole artifact. It's basically the data and the analysis on top of it. You shared it out to a BI site so that we could access it and consume all of this work. But essentially, this is the end product that you've shared. A lot of what needs to happen in business is sharing earlier artifacts in that workflow. If you think about the steps that information workers typically go through, they involve the needs identification, you know, what's the problem I'm trying to solve, the identification of the data that they need. So like, okay, so in order for me to justify this decision or to get funding for this project or to close this support ticket or, you know, to, you know, whatever the business problem is, they've identified data or data domains that they need. But even for different uses of the same data, the end product is going to be different, or it's often different. By looking at the sharing of queries rather than the sharing of workbooks, instead of sharing the final end product, essentially what we're enabling is sharing the building blocks, which can then be used in multiple workbooks in multiple contexts. And the person that does this is often a data steward. So if we could switch back to the slides real quick here. Essentially, the data steward is the person responsible or ultimately responsible for a business process and the data around it. Now, I'm not going to attempt to read all of the information on this slide, but what I do want to do is I want to describe the data steward. So a data steward is someone who works in the business and knows whether or not the data is right or wrong. He's typically a little bit more senior. He's been on the team for a longer time. And he's typically someone that works with the IT department for projects like a new data warehouse or a new BI effort, master data adoption or data quality projects. And because of this, he has both a deep insight into and a deep understanding of the business processes and the data, but he also probably knows more about, you know, things like tables and views and stored procedures than your average business person will be. He's not technical, but he might know how to write a select statement, for example. And the key thing is, a lot of data stewards don't know that they're data stewards. You know, one of the things that I get to do is to meet with lots of companies and customers who are adopting our technology or considering our technology. And a lot of the companies that I've been talking with over the last year or so have been at various stages of implementing or identifying data stewardship programs. And in most of these companies, the people that perform the data stewardship duties, their job titles are business analyst or data analyst or maybe even finance manager or sales manager. You know, they're someone that runs that part of the business, not someone whose core responsibility is often data. A lot of bigger companies are companies that have recognized the strategic importance and the strategic differentiation of having the data available and curated and correct. They now have data steward as a formal job title and a formal responsibility. But in the majority of companies today, it's more of an informal thing. It's something that you do rather than something that you're assigned. And there's one conversation that I was having, basically sitting in a meeting for a pretty big company that was formally rolling out their data stewardship program. And basically, they had a lot of their executives, so the, you know, the VPs that needed the data at the right time, you know, the right data at the right time, and a lot of the managers that were responsible for getting that data to them. And the person running this program, he asked one of the VPs, it's like, hey, you know, if you had questions about, you know, how much of this was sold in this region to these companies and being used in this way, who would you go to ask that question if you needed to know right away? And, you know, he immediately, it's, oh, it's Bob. And Bob looked around, it's like, oh no, I'm the data steward, aren't I? You know, thinking that it's like now he's going to have more responsibilities and be asked more to do with the hours that he has. Fortunately, Bob was already the data steward. He now got to be recognized for it, for the work that he was already doing. So let's take a look back at the slides, see some technology. So we've identified sort of this problem space. We've got this dark data. What are the pieces that we're going to be putting together to help address that problem? First and foremost, we have the data catalog. I like to think of the data catalog as really the magic glue that holds the entire scenario together. But if we look at it from a more technical perspective, the data catalog is a set of cloud services that are part of the Office 365 component of Power BI. They include a metadata catalog. So this metadata catalog is where the information about any query or some other artifacts that get shared between users in Power BI, there is a search crawler and a search index. So essentially, anything that gets shared up there is going to get crawled and added to the index so that when anyone is searching through this corporate catalog from Excel, they will be able to find the resources that are that have been shared. And it has, as you'll see later on this afternoon, it has capabilities for connecting back to on-prem data, connecting back to on-prem data through a data integration layer. The key thing to keep in mind when we share things into this data catalog, we're actually sharing metadata. We're sharing the definition of the query, but we're not sharing the query that's been returned. And one of the things that's very important to stress is that if I share a query, in order for me to build that query, I need to have been assigned permissions to access the data that the query was based on. Otherwise, I couldn't do the things that Matt was showing off inside of Power Query earlier this morning or earlier in the event. But when I share it, That query is essentially the instructions for how to connect to the data. If you were to go to open up one of these queries, if you didn't have permission to access the database or the file server or wherever I had the information or wherever the information was being sourced from, you wouldn't be able to open it until you had gotten permissions. We're going to touch back on that, too.
Which is definitely a misconception, right? People think you got the query published and you're exposed. You exposed all the data. You don't. You still need to have the permissions to get access to the data.
Yeah, absolutely. And the key thing is, one of our guiding principles is don't irritate the DBA. And nothing would irritate a DBA more than giving someone permission to the data that the DBA is responsible for securing. What we want to do with sharing queries and through the data search inside the catalog, we want to ensure that anyone who searches for the data that has permissions to see that it's in the catalog, again, we'll take a look at that in a second, that they can be aware that it exists. We want to make sure that the owner of the query or the owner of the data can make their processes for getting access to the data as exposed and open and understood as possible, but we never want to give anyone access to the data that doesn't have it. We don't want to reinvent that wheel or open that door.
I want to thank you real quick for what you just said there.
Yeah.
Coming from a developer, right? Don't irritate the DBA. That's like really important. I like that a lot.
Yes.
Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. So beyond the data catalog, you've already seen Power Queries. This is another one of the primary components here. We'll look at this a little bit in my demo coming up, but I think that Matt has really covered a lot of the details. Key thing in my mind is that Power Query gives Excel users the ability to connect to data, to shape the data, and to create a data set. As a data professional, you know, I've done SQL Server stuff for many, many years. I'm used to creating views and stored procedures, you know, these database objects that represent a table of data. A Power Query is essentially a view that sits on top of the database itself. It's not in it. It exists outside and can access all of the different data sources that Matt was showing off. We also have, outside of Excel, as part of the Office 365 experience, we have a data management portal. The data management portal is where a data steward, someone who has shared a query, can go to monitor activity, to see information, do some management tasks for the queries that he has shared. Essentially, you can think of it as a dashboard for the resources that you've shared with the organization. You can see how they're being used, who's using them, look at trends over time, maybe identify additional capabilities or additional needs in how the data is being accessed. And finally, is from the broader self-service information management perspective, there's also an admin center which will allow IT administrators or IT pros to share information or share data sources on-prem to make the on-prem data available. I'm not going to talk about this in any depth in this session, but I believe Majdi, towards the end of the day, is going to be looking at this in a lot more detail. Now, moving away from the specific modules, let's look at some of the publishing scenarios. I want to highlight that it's a hybrid publishing because we do have the two different ways that we can share our data artifacts. Over on the right-hand side, we've got the admin center where an IT admin or potentially a data steward, if the data steward has been granted permissions to access this, can connect to the corporate data, install a data management gateway, as Majdi will show this afternoon, to make that data available to data consumers in the cloud. But the core scenario really revolves around Power Query, where you have an information worker or a data steward connecting to that data and then sharing the query itself. So essentially that script, you remember Matt showed off that Power Query script, the code behind the scenes. We're taking that code and the metadata that we provide, the name, the description, documentation, certification, to share this information up into the data catalog. Also want to stress that the data catalog itself has two primary components. Every Power BI for Office 365 tenant gets their own corporate data catalog. This is where the queries and the metadata are being shared. It's available only to that one particular organization. But Microsoft also runs a public data catalog, where this cloud data coming in from Wikipedia, from data.gov, and other public sources, this data is indexed and searchable, and it's federated with all Power BI customers. So when you search against the data catalog, by default, you're searching both the corporate data and the public data, although I think Matt showed this off, and I'll show this off later on as well. You can filter to say, only show me corporate data, only show me public data, if that's your need. Mm-hmm. All right, so before we go into the demo, I put this in the slide because I always forget to mention this until the end if it's not in there to remind me. The thing that I want to stress about data stewardship is that this is a virtuous cycle of data stewardship. So if you think about metadata from a general perspective, we've had tools, you know, the industry as a whole has had tools for entering things like descriptions and documentation and the like. But as a general rule, if I put effort into documenting my data, you know, essentially saying, this is where it comes from, this is how you use it, this is how it's designed to be used, don't use it for these things, you know, how does the data apply to the business? When I put this together, it's generally a lost cause because people will find the data from one direction and they've got to go in a different direction to find that documentation. So there's not really a lot of incentive to invest in this valuable intellectual property. But with Power BI, and specifically with the sharing of queries in Power BI, we can ensure that the metadata that the query author is specifying always appears when the query is being consumed. So if you go out and search for something that I've shared, if I've taken the time to document this, you'll be able to understand right from the beginning. As a data steward, people come and they knock on my door and they say, Matthew, you know, could you please help me find this data? Or is this the right thing to use? Or how do I get access to this or that? With Power BI, by specifying this up front, when someone discovers the data in Excel, they will be able to understand how it's designed to be used, how to use it, how to get access to it, both from a description or documentation perspective, as well as from a functional perspective, again, as we'll see. So let's jump in here. I'm actually going to switch over into Power Query. So I've got a brand new Excel workbook that I've set up. The one thing that I do want to stress is that I have... let me do this. Hold on. We got Zoom It and Remote Desktop. I'm not the best of friends. We got you here. You're not just... There we go. So I have signed in, so if you are using the Power Query add-in but you have not yet signed up for a Power BI trial, or if you're not yet a Power BI for Office 365 customer, you will see sign in here where I see sign out. If you do see sign in, a lot of the capabilities that I'm about to walk through won't be available to you. We are relying on the cloud capabilities here. So what I'm going to do, unlike Matt's queries, I'm going to do something super simple using a traditional data source. I'm going to go against my corporate data warehouse. Let me type this guy in here. I can't type and talk at the same time. I apologize for that. But I am going to connect to my AdventureWorks data warehouse, and I'm going to pull in information about products. Now, the reason that I'm doing this, and it's important to stress the reason, because if you think about it, I'm in the business. I'm not going against data because I love the data. I'm going against data for a specific reason. And in this particular example, I need to find information about clothing and accessories because my company is considering a partnership with a new supplier for clothing and accessories. We're hoping to get a better margin. We're trying to improve the business, increase our reach. But in order to do this, I need to share with other users in the business information about the current products and accessories that we sell. And I know that this data warehouse is the authoritative source for this data. But unfortunately, I've got one table for products and one for categories and one for subcategories. Most of the users that I work with, they can't do a join, right? So I am going to start with DIM product. And I'm going to choose edit. And essentially, I'm going to kick off the query creation experience. And I'm going to start off by hiding some of the columns that we don't need or that I don't need, that I don't want my users to have to be bothered with. So let's get these guys out of the way. But perhaps the most important thing is that I am going to be coming down and expanding out my product subcategory. So we'll expand this guy. I want that subcategory name, and I want the product category related table. So basically, let me scroll over. Basically, what we're doing here is walking through the relationships that are in the database. So even though these are in related tables, let's do this. Let's say we've got our category, we've got our subcategory, we have only, actually not that. It's categories that we're interested in. The filter was two tables away. So we've got accessories and clothing. We filter on this. And we're only interested in the current products as well. So right now, I've got a quick table that I put together. It's, you know, think about it as a view. I've joined together three different tables from the database. And I will now provide some descriptive metadata. I will say clothing and accessories. And where is my, come on, my screen resolution is not my friend. Oh, there, thank you. So as Matt mentioned as well, this is one of the challenges of having, one of the challenges of working with a lot of the early builds is when things move around, you get used to where they used to be. So I have now created this query. Got all the information, we've got all the data loaded into the worksheet. But remember, the reason that I've created this is that this data set and the shape of the data set is something that will be valuable for other users in the business. So I want to share it. I'll right-click and choose share, although I could also do it up in the toolbar and so on. And let me spend a little bit of time, well, first of all, typing in and walking through some of the options that we have here on the share query dialog. First and foremost, we have a query name. This is something that will show up in the results, going to let people know what the data is that they're looking at. We also have a description. This will also show up anywhere that the query appears. Let me come over into SharePoint real quick. I've spent some time documenting this data set, so I will. Well, first, I might as well click through. So this is something that I see more and more in larger organizations or more mature organizations and related to data management and information management is having full documentation, sometimes even with video or resources, for their key business data sets and data sources. So I'm going to take this existing documentation, which I've shared up on my team SharePoint site, and get you here. I'm going to put the URL to this into the share query dialog so that whenever the query appears in search results, the documentation will be immediately available so that any user can click through and see whatever they need about this. I also want to point out that we have a list of data sources that are being used by the query. This is one of the most important things from a data catalog perspective, in that we track the lineage between data sources, queries, and moving forward other artifacts. Once they're created and once they're shared, we understand the relationships between them. So we might be able to say, you know, these are the data sources that are being used by the largest number of businesses or the largest number of teams, for example. Let's go back to that dialog real quick, because I want to point out, can we switch back to the screen, please? There we go. So I want to point out that currently the data source is listed as AdventureWorks Data Warehouse. There is a business-friendly name here, but if I hover over this, come on, let's see if, there we go. Come on. Well, you saw the little flyout appear here. Essentially, the reason that we have the business-friendly name appearing is because the system, this data catalog, is already aware of this data source. I've shared information or I've shared queries based on this data source previously, or a user in my organization has, and I've taken the time to annotate this data source as well. So by clicking on that View in Portal link from inside Power Query, I can then pull up information about this specific data source. And just as we've annotated and documented the query itself, We also have the ability to annotate and document the data source so that anytime this is appearing as part of the Power BI experience, we have a full set of information that's appearing. Let me zoom in here real quick. As you can tell, some of this is simply descriptive. So, you know, here's a business name so that your information workers, your Excel users, aren't scared off by the full path to the database. But the key thing, the key part of functional metadata is an approver for access requests. This is either an email address or a URL, but this circles back around to the don't irritate the DBA guiding principle. If you think about this, every database that's out there, you know, be it SQL Server or SharePoint or, you know, a document on a shared folder, or, you know, shared folder full of text files, each one of these data sources is owned by a team. There's someone responsible to keep the data up to date and to keep it secure. And whether it's formal and well documented or informal and ad hoc, each one of these data sources has a security policy, you know, some set of steps that users would go through to get access to it. And at Microsoft, we use Forefront Identity Manager. It's sort of a self-service identity management tool. At Microsoft, for the queries that we share and the data sources that they're based on, we will put in the URL for that group in Forefront Identity Manager so that anyone who sees a query based on this data source who doesn't have access to that data source, well, the first thing that will happen is they'll get prompted for credentials, but in that credential dialog box, they will see a request access link. They click on the link. It takes them directly to the page where they can request access to join the group, and then the approver can handle it through their existing processes. What I've done in the demo here is I've simply put in an email address. When a user clicks on that request access link, it will fire off an email, or I should say open up an email that they can then send requesting access for that source so that someone can go through a manual process. I've also seen people who are using this where they will put in a link to their documented process. They don't have an automated tool, but they also don't want to share the team's email or individual DBA's email. So what they do is they have the documentation for the process and they have that shared there. So let's jump back into the demo. I've got my name, my description, the list of data sources. I can also, because I am a member of the data steward role, I can say that this is a certified query. This is essentially saying inside the system, this is the official or authoritative set of data. This means that when this query shows up in search results, it's going to have an icon or a description next to it. It's also going to have a higher relevance, or our search algorithms are going to give it a higher precedence so that you're more likely to see this because it's certified. Everything else that we're seeing here is available to anyone with a Power BI license. We want to make sure that as a business user, when you create a query, you have the ability to share it with your colleagues, keeping in mind you're not sharing the data, you're not giving access, you're simply making people aware that the data is there. Only data stewards, only people who have been explicitly added to the Power BI data steward role have the ability to certify queries.
So when you certify, does that mean it shows up top of the list?
So we're not going to say top of the list. If you think
higher
about
ranking,
absolutely.
Based on the query, of course.
Based on the query, based on what you're searching on, and how the query is being found by the search process, it will be higher. We don't guarantee it's at the top. So it's a little bit more complicated than that. So let's actually jump back down to the screen as well for one last point. The other thing that we want to stress is that when we're sharing it, we get to specify who will even be able to see this query in the search results. The default is everyone in the enterprise because, you know, it's all about data discovery. When you share it, you probably want people to be able to find it. But you can specify either share it only with yourself, if, for example, this is something that you just want to be able to find later without having to recreate it or have a file with it stored anywhere, or you can specify specific users and groups. So for example, if I were to come in here and type in, oh, there we go, Matt Mason, I could share. Okay, I can't actually type very well today. But if I were to type in Matt, we'll get our standard people picker type experience. But I'm going to leave this as everyone in the enterprise, and I will choose. Oh, let me actually stress one additional thing. I almost forgot this last one. We also can choose to upload the first few rows. Currently, we upload, I believe it's 20 rows, but we have that may change over time, but we can say that we're going to upload the first few rows for preview. So this way, when someone finds the query in the search results, they get the same flyout that you've seen earlier today, so they can look at the data, see what columns there are, what the data is in there. If this is sensitive data, if even sharing a preview of it would be too much, you can clear that. I'm going to leave that checked, and I'm going to choose share a copy. I've now pushed this information, the query, so that script behind the scenes, as well as the metadata around it, I have pushed it up into the cloud, and I can now see, so I'm coming back to my Power Query tab, and I'm going to click on this share button. I can now see all of the queries that I've shared. If I hover over this guy, let's just take a look. Notice that we've got the certified icon, the little green ribbon icon that's showing up. I've got all of the information that I've shared, so a lot of it being inferred, so you know we can click on a column to see the contents of that column, and we can click on the documentation URL to navigate directly to the documentation so that I, as a consumer, can then read through this and understand, is this the data? How am I supposed to use it? Or is it the data that I need? How am I supposed to use it? And so on. And shared, I can see it inside Excel as part of my my shared queries. So these are all things that I have shared previously, but I can also, inside the Power BI for Office 365 experience, I can come to this My Power BI site, or the data management portal, and I can view information both about the queries that I've shared. So we've got the full list of all of the queries that I've shared, and I can search and filter and sort and so on. I can view information about the data sources on which queries have been shared or queries have been built, and view and edit their metadata with the same navigation capabilities. And I can also view usage analytics about the queries that I've shared. So let me actually, since I'm using a demo tenant, this isn't the actual Microsoft corporate tenant, since this is something that I use primarily for demos, there's not a lot of activity, and even less of it is within the last 30 days. But when I choose queries or change the range for the last year, I can see there's a spike. Interestingly enough, there's a spike around PASS and then a spike around the other presentations that I was doing in that time frame. And I can see which queries are the most popular. So how many times have these queries that I've shared shown up in search, and how many times they have actually been opened inside of Excel. Now, I can use this information to see what is or what are the areas of interest for the users who are searching, and also by the relationship between the two, I can see where there are gaps as well. To get back to the concept of a virtuous cycle, we can look at the usage information for the queries that we've shared to see, let's say, for example, something is showing up very high in the search results but almost never gets clicked through. We might be able to review that query and identify that there's information that's missing, or perhaps there's another query shared by another user that people are using preferentially.
So we talk about corporate BI, self-service BI scenarios a lot, right? I mean, if you switch back to your query window there.
Yes.
Like the portal there.
Oh, let's go back to the portal. Go ahead.
So if you look at the portal, this is how, as an IT pro, a DBA, a data administrator, I can manage all that, look at the query consumption. As you mentioned, being able to certify a query, that's really where the self-service corporate BI scenario comes together, isn't it?
Yeah, let's actually tie this together with a story. I have a feeling that, you know, I tend to talk a lot. You've noticed that already. I was trying to move away from the story, but let's actually tie this together because it's a great point. When we have corporate BI and we have self-service BI, there's always a little bit of tension between the two, but what this does, or what this enables, is it enables someone, without needing to work with corporate IT or without needing to rely on them, to be able to create, to share, and then monitor these data artifacts, these queries. Because if you think about it, it's the data set, it's the view, it's the definition of the data. IT still manages the data itself, but by enabling business to close that gap, we've freed both of them from each other. One of the most One of the most successful scenarios that I've seen, this is actually a collaboration between Microsoft and Intel. One of the business groups at Intel has been making a big effort towards self-service business intelligence over the last couple years. And what they've done, they've essentially said, look, we're IT. We're going to own the corporate data model. It's our responsibility. It's our mandate. This is not going to change. But as I mentioned up front, they also have recognized that the needs of the business and the agility that business requires in the context of getting access to new data and the right data at the right time, business can't wait for IT's predefined big cycles. So they've been using our self-service BI tools, specifically Power Pivot and Power View, because a lot of this was before Power BI was available. But they have worked with data stewards in the business and have essentially said, if there's something that you need that's not in the data model, these are the tools that you can use to do it. So I need this extra column. I need a different filter. I need a different pivot of the data. They've enabled, you know, through tools and through training, they've enabled the business to go do that. And they've set up an ongoing sync. They get together every week or every other week where the business people can either say, we need help on this thing, or they can say, we have gotten the data that we need. This is the thing that isn't in the corporate data model that we need to be there. And by the way, it's functional. It's not documentation. Here's the data model that we've created with 90% of it is the stuff that you own already, but here's this other 10% that we need. IT, we the business are now handing this over to you. Please take it and manage it. And they have a cycle that's measured in weeks, not months and not years, to have the things that business needed identified, defined, prototyped, and then implemented in the corporate data model. So IT still manages it. They just have a healthier and more interactive relationship with these key business stakeholders. And perhaps the most exciting thing is that even though it's a matter of weeks before it gets into the corporate data model, business doesn't even need to wait for that. The business users that are creating these queries and creating these Power Pivot models, they're able to simply start using these things before they even hand them off to IT. They iterate, they get it done.
Well, so one of the things that I see is how a corporate BI scenario could really be enhanced by a self-service, right? I mean, you mentioned bringing in additional data, but the question is, do you really want some of those data sets that you want to bring in to get the fast insights? Yep. Do you want to bring those into a corporate data scenario? Like, for example, if I'm a company that's shipping packages across the world, right? Yep. Now, of course, I want to have my customer information where my packages go and so on, but am I going to bring in information about weather-related issues, whether there are certain delays at certain airports and so on? By the time you get that, the package should already be delivered if you want to enroll that into a corporate model. Being able to combine that corporate BI scenario with a self-service and connecting to the world's data, being able to leverage that Power Query through multiple APIs and enhancing that data model, I think that's one of the strengths of Power BI and the capabilities.
Yeah, I definitely agree there. So having the ability to do with these self-service tools things that aren't efficient or aren't possible through the corporate tools, that's a real enabler. But at the same time, we don't want anyone to have the takeaway that Power BI is replacing traditional corporate enterprise BI. They're very complementary tools. And if you think about this breakdown, in our corporate BI tool set or product set, we have integration services, SQL Server integration services, which is our ETL tool. We have SQL Server analysis services, which is the analytics engine. We have SQL Server reporting services, which is the data visualization and reporting tool. And each one of these, to one degree or another, is designed for professionals, you know, for programmers, for developers, for administrators, for people who have invested in the tool set and the skill set, not for business people. In Power BI, we have Power Query, which is a self-service ETL tool. We have Power Pivot, which is an in-Excel analytics engine. We have Power View and Power Map, which are these self-service interactive visualization tools. Each one of them has a role to play or a place in today's corporate or today's business data world. But it's really a matter of understanding what your needs are, not just the needs of the data, but the needs of the business. You know, what are the problems that you're trying to solve, to understand which is the most important or which is the right tool for you to use in your situation.
Okay. So, perfect. With that, we're on the hour. What we're going to do here in Redmond is we're going to take our one-hour lunch break, and we'll be back after lunch with quite some interesting scenarios that we're going to be looking at. So we'll be looking on how we're going to build Power View reports, do data visualizations with Power Map as well, and then we're going to look on how we can integrate that corporate data that we talked about, getting access from Power BI to corporate data using the data management gateway. And then last but not least, we're going to look at the capabilities we have with Q&A, being able to optimize those data models for natural language query. So stay tuned and be back with us in an hour. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Andy.
Thanks, Matthew.